So we're here right after the ARM press conference here at Computex, and you announced new ARM processor.
Yes, so this morning we talked about the next generation of ARM Cortex technology. We announced the Cortex-A75 and the A55 processors. These are the first two processors that match up with ARM's dynamic technology. And as you know, dynamic technology allows you to build more integrated, more heterogeneous systems, and are designed ground up to support better AI functionality, better robustness and reliability features, both for enterprise as well as functional safety critical applications such as automotive, and how to connect in better acceleration, again, for better improved machine learning, computer vision capability, as well as more integrated infrastructure solutions. This also complements the announcement of the Mali G72 GPU that goes along with all of this.
So dynamic, ARM dynamic, does it have to do with cache current, interconnect kind of stuff?
So ARM dynamic is the platform which will be the basis for the next few generations of processors. Yes, it involves a level 3 caching system, but alongside that, it is about design. It's a cluster that can support up to 8 cores, and each of those can be different in configuration and capability, but architecturally compliant. But also, this system is designed so as to support more enterprise-ready robustness features, and they also support cache stashing and architecturally different capabilities like data poisoning, etc., that are built into CPUs. It's also dynamic, built from the ground up, so that it can be certified for ASIL-D or functional safety critical capabilities.
So are you announcing now that there's more cache closer to each core? Is it something that's similar to what Intel is doing on a Xeon, or, I mean, without asking specifically, but does that provide a whole new performance?
So as we've gone about, naturally we have level one caching gone up to 64 kilobytes for configurably for both A75 and A55. What we've done this time around, as a part of this dynamic capability, is each core now has a private L2, again, very configurable, to reduce the latency into the core itself, but also giving it the level of isolation needed so that each core can operate independently in a larger level 3 system. As things get more complex and as performance, we go up the performance curve, naturally a large part of the benefit is going to come from well-designed memory systems that also need layered caching for them.
And now you announced a whole bunch of new cluster configurations. It doesn't have to be, it could be 5+1 or something like that? Or
right.
What is it?
So certainly dynamic is a platform supports up to 8 cores in a cluster. It's naturally a good fit for big.LITTLE, because not only can you do transactions between cores much faster and transaction of state between cores much faster, it uses the same software as before. What now this offers you is a flexibility to put in a different set of configurations of big and little. In the traditional context before, you had maximum of 4 cores per cluster. So if you wanted to do 1 big and 7 little, it wasn't easy to do without adding a third cluster. Whereas now, in an 8-core cluster, you could have just 1 big processor, especially in a mainstream kind of setup that gives you the single thread performance you need, but then taken up with 6, 7 little cores that actually give you that throughput and bandwidth while maintaining the power efficiency of that system.
So the big.LITTLE idea and all these clusters definitely has turned out to be the right way to do things, right? You want to have different clusters, you want to have even some A55s might be smaller than the other A55s and like some bigger ones.
Yes, so the one thing that we can certainly say is across the smartphone world and certainly into some of the larger clamshell form factors as well, big.LITTLE is pretty much everywhere. It's ubiquitous, right? And that comes from the fact that you can do the right amount of compute for the right workload and actually have the flexibility to do that anytime. What dynamic does now is takes it to the next level because the efficiency has grown, plus it has given you a lot more scope for mixing and matching the right level of performance for the cluster that you choose.
And in your keynote, you were talking about notebook, laptop, push. Like there's a new push there, right? You're doing even more performance, but still keeping it a mobile power consumption.
So as you know, I mean, the A73 generation or last generation class, you are seeing much more push into the clamshell form factor. What A75 does is now pushes up that to another level. As we said, compared to 2.4 gigahertz products today in the smartphone world with A73, an A75 in 10 nanometer about probably be at 3 gigahertz, but still providing over 50% raw integer performance. The floating point performance would be even higher, and specialized AI type workloads would be much, much more than that. So what that really does is provides you with a substantially better performing processor, which can support large screen compute form factors, but still maintain the efficiency that is expected for a smartphone.
Is this targeted towards 7 nanometers, 8 nanometers, 10 nanometers, or any?
So firstly, all the IP we provide is portable. So you could take it to any process node of your choice. We expect for the premium mobile side, this will first show up in 10 nanometer. But realistically, it would be still a very good fit in 16 nanometer or 14 nanometer as well. And if you look at the A55, which is more mainstream, you could see it in 16, you could see it in 20, or even 28 for that matter. So really, this is a very wide set of solutions. Will it go into 7 nanometer? There's nothing stopping it from it.
And so those are two new 64-bit chips, and they are coming with ARM V8.2 pre-installed, or how do you say?
That is good. So they're built on the ARM V8.2 architecture. So that builds on V8, which has 64-bit capability, but adds in a few key benefits beyond that. Firstly, we provide atomic operations that are more targeted towards enterprise-type applications where large sets of clusters can work even better and more efficiently together. We have advanced virtualization support well beyond what we had today, so make transitions between guest operating virtual systems faster. But V8.2 adds in a lot of advanced features beyond that. Firstly, for reliability, it has more features. It also adds more enterprise features to enable data movement and cache stashing that can pre-populate what the accelerators work on and what the cores work on.
And do you enable more innovation in accelerators on the SoC? People can put more stuff now?
Absolutely. So this is actually more where dynamic comes in because it allows the accelerators to plug right in. And what we've done is improve the latency and the bandwidth that it's capable of addressing these accelerators in a much better way. So you could see neural net type accelerators plugging in for AI type solutions. You could see deep packet inspection or other cryptography accelerators for networking or infrastructure type solutions. And all of this in a more efficient fashion. So it feels much more tight-knit in a heterogeneous computing environment.
And so there's a heterogeneous computing kind of consortium and some other consortiums you announced that you're part of to get all the industry players to work together on this interconnect solutions, right?
Yes, so we have worked with heterogeneous computing before. We continue to do so. And if anything right now, for the networking server world and infrastructure world, there are a lot more OpenNFV, OpenDPDK, all those types of platforms coming in as well that allow the main software stacks to run on the core, but also allow for differentiated solutions to link into acceleration or specialized hardware underneath.
So there might be, there will be some awesome laptops. There will be, this is potentially good for servers also?
Indeed. So certainly, as we said, laptop class or notebook class performance now available in a smartphone envelope, so you could certainly see that. In the infrastructure world, again, efficiency is still key. You have more threads on the same amount of die. Compute density is really what people are looking for. And with the advanced performance, advanced floating point capability, advanced AI capability, which still stays within a much more tight constrained budget, it really changes how infrastructure solutions can be delivered. It improves the TCO versus incumbent architectures.
And the chip makers are allowed to take your designs and modify, and there's new licenses that has been announced, right? That they can take and tweak and improve.
So let me clarify this first. So if you're talking about the built-on-ARM Cortex technology, it is not meant for partners to take and modify. We work with the partner. We take a standard product, work with the partner to modify it to the partner's needs, but we still deliver the product.
All right. So this is 2018. Every time you announce and it comes 2018, but every time there's some people shipping before the end of 2017 anyways. So that's maybe possible again?
So naturally, there's always going to be prototypes before volume silicon. We expect A75 and A55 based platforms to actually hit devices and market shelves certainly by the second half of 18, probably sooner, which naturally means that there will be prototype platforms before that. Some of them may be early production as well. So we do expect that in the not too distant future.
And the A75 sounds awesome, but maybe the big volume is the successor of the A53, which is the successor of the A7, right? Which is a huge volume. And so what have you done to improve that market?
So if you look at the Cortex-A55, as you say, it has a lot of great history. A7 has been one of the most popular cores that has gone into the mainstream as well as the entry-level market. The Cortex-A53 did the same thing. Three generations of products, if not more, that were designed for the mainstream and the entry-level market. What A55 does is now improves the performance, improves the efficiency, and gives more capability. So you could see more AI type workloads being run on an A55, and that changes the way you see mainstream smartphones today. Plus, it puts that into edge compute, into single board computing, into industrial and home automation, into edge and IoT. So really, A55 takes what A7 and A53 have done and takes it to the next level.
And it's tiny, right? It's such a small part of the...
Still a very, very compact part.
So compact, but a whole bunch more.
So, yes, we continue to focus on mainstream with A55 for greater performance, greater capability, while maintaining or substantially improving the efficiency for that segment.